about the introductory statements of hydrogen and its compounds. So, sir, the hydrogen is reacting with metals and non-metals to give hydrides. We have learned about it. And now in these hydrides, there are three types we agreed upon. What are those three types, sir? Salt-like or saline hydrides. Covalent hydrides. And of course, interstitial hydrates. What are hydrates? Compounds formed by hydrogen with other elements. The salt-like hydrates are given by S-block elements. Covalent hydrates are given by P-block elements. The interstitial elements are given by D and F-block elements. We understood that. But in the D and F blocks, we noticed that the 7th group, 8th group and 9th group elements do not make hydrates. What are the 7th group elements? What are 8th group elements? What are 9th group elements? So now they can make a question. Which of the following elements cannot give hydrides? That is a question. They can give you options like zinc, cadmium, mercury, borium. Which cannot give hydride means borium, because borium is in 7th group. So they can take any of these and ask a question like, which cannot make a hydride? Along with others, any one they can do. Or else, they can make a question like, which of the following can make a hydride? First option, manganese. Second option, technetium. Third option, ruthenium. Fourth option, say, chromium. Therefore, whatever that is there in this list cannot make hydride. That is first point. Second point. Hydrides made by D and F block elements are called interstitial hydrides, because in the metal, atoms are packed like this. This is called close packed arrangement. These are the atoms of metal packed like this. When the atoms are packed like this, there is a gap here, there is a gap here, there is a gap here. There is a gap here, gap here. Gap here. In 6th group, chromium can make hydride, but molybdenum, tungsten and seaborgium cannot make hydrides. So you should know which fellows are not making hydrides. That you should know. After knowing that, how they make hydrides, we see. The atoms of D and F block elements, they are like this packed. This is called close packed arrangement. Okay. In this close packed arrangement, we can call it as HCP, hexagonal close packed arrangement. Why are you calling it as hexagonal close packing? Let us see. My voice is breaking. My God. The signal is poor, man. The signal is poor. Now see here. These are the atoms. Atoms of metals which are making hydrides. This is called close packed line. Next line. Now, in this arrangement, please notice, this is the way atoms of metals exist in, say, iron metal. In, say, titanium metal in copper metal. In solid metal, atoms pack such that one atom is touching the other atom. Atoms are like spheres. It is called close packed arrangement of metal atoms. If you carefully see here, this atom is in touch with how many atoms? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Because each atom is in touch with 6 atoms, I call it as hexagonal close packed arrangement. In this arrangement, I can see a gap between this atom and this atom and this atom. This is a gap. Can you see that? Here is a gap. Here is a gap. Here is a gap. These gaps are called interstitials. In metals, the gaps between the atoms are called interstitials. Or they are called voids. I can draw a void beautifully like this, sir. These are 3 particles. Can you see there is a gap here? Again,
yes, sir.
These are 3 particles. Can you see a gap here? Sir, if you take out the layer B and put on A, take B and put on A, how it looks? It is a bottom layer. It is the top layer. So the hole in the bottom layer is coinciding with the hole in top layer. It is a big hole. This big hole is called octahedral void. In these gaps, hydrogen atoms sit. Because how there are so many gaps, if there are n atoms of metal, there are 2n small gaps called tetrahedral voids. There are n big gaps called octahedral voids. Notice this is called small tetrahedral void. There are many tetrahedral voids. For X atom, there are X tetrahedral voids. And these voids, which are formed by placing one layer over the other, octahedral voids, if the N atoms are making a metallic crystal, there will be 2N tetrahedral voids, N octahedral voids. What we are talking is how the atoms in metals are arranged. Let it be any metal. It can be gold metal. It can be platinum metal. It can be palladium metal. I don't care. In metal, atoms are packed so that one is touching the other. And when the atoms are so packed, called as stacking, there arise gaps. The gaps can be there in one plane or they can be there in 3-dimensional arrangement. There are 2 types of gaps. One gap is small, like this. This is called tetrahedral void. One gap is big, like this. It is called octahedral void. For any atoms, there are 2N tetrahedral voids, N octahedral voids. Now, what happens in this metal, in these gaps, some gaps are filled by hydrogen. How many gaps are filled, nobody knows. It varies. So, if you look at the formula of these compounds, it looks very strange. They say ZrH1.5. Means, for every 10 zirconium atoms, there are 15 hydrogen atoms. Or in some other place, they say its formula ZrH.8. It means, out of 10 zinc atoms, only there are 8 hydrogen atoms which are trapped in the gaps. Because here hydrogens are getting trapped in the gaps, they don't have a definite number. That varies. Compounds which don't have a definite formula are called non-stoichiometric compounds. So, these are non-stoichiometric hydrides. And in this, the platinum and palladium are so special.
What is Henry, sir?
Excuse me, what did you say?
What is n, sir?
What is n? If there are n atoms of metal, there are 2n gaps called tetrahedral voids. There are n gaps called octahedral voids. If there are 10 atoms, when they are packed, they can give rise to 20 small gaps and 10 big gaps. Small gap is called tetrahedral void. Big gap is called octahedral void. You can see it yourself. If you take balls or oranges, if you arrange them like this, you can see the gaps. These gaps are tetrahedral voids. If you are placing one more layer over them, suppose you are placing one more layer. When you place one more layer, you get gaps, more gaps. These gaps are two types, small gaps, big gaps. Small gaps are called tetrahedral voids. Big gaps are called octahedral voids. If there are, this is a small gap tetrahedral void. It is another small tetrahedral void. If you put this layer B over layer A, you get a big gap like this. This is called octahedral. So in these gaps, hydrogen atoms are sitting. Hence, these compounds are called interstitial compounds. In interstitial compounds, there is no different formula. Among us, these interstitial compounds, I should notice that palladium and platinum are special. So we were wondering what are voids. We agreed upon that voids are gaps. We agreed upon that the metals have gaps, and in these gaps the hydrogen atoms are sitting. That makes a non-stoichiometric hydride. Non-stoichiometric hydrides formed by palladium and platinum are very important. Reason. 1 gram of platinum can absorb as much as 1,000 grams of hydrogen. My God. Oh. The super ability of platinum palladium to absorb hydrogen is known as occlusion. Therefore, in order to store hydrogen, often platinum palladium are used. So this is a note on hydrides. We have completed about hydrogen in all formats. You should know what is hydrolith. Calcium hydride is called hydrolith. Why it is important? When calcium hydride called hydrolith reacts with water, you get calcium hydroxide and it is the easiest way to generate hydrogen gas. The hydrolith is used as a source of hydrogen. Hydrolith is nickname of calcium hydroxide. Also, the beryllium, generally S block hydrides are ionic. Ionic hydrides are given by S block metals. They have very high melting points, boiling points. Their solids don't conduct current, but in liquid state on heating, they conduct current. And they react with water to give hydrogen. All that is known. But in S block, lithium, beryllium, and magnesium hydrides have more covalent nature. In fact, beryllium magnesium hydrides are existing like polymers. Poly means many, mer means molecule. Generally, covalent compounds have tendency to exist as polymers. Your hair is a polymer. Cotton is a polymer. Paper is a polymer. Poly means many. Mer means molecule. Many molecules can join together and live together. That is a property of covalent compounds. So beryllium and magnesium hydrides, though basically they are ionic, they exist with more covalent in nature. They are polymeric in nature. Though he is a boy, he has more female characters. His breast is high, you can say. Then you are saying, basically he is a male, but female characters. Basically, S-block elements make ionic hydrides, but the hydrides made by beryllium and magnesium have more covalent nature. You are saying that boy has more feminine nature. How he is having feminine nature? You look at his sat, you are saying. So how they have more covalent nature? They are existing like polymers, you are saying. So this is a note on hydrides. Here we conclude. Okay, sir. In examination point of view, there is a question, sample question. Which of these cannot make a hydride? Example, molybdenum, tungsten, seaborgium, chromium. Which of the following can make hydride? Answer is chromium. In the chromium family, only chromium makes hydride. Other members of chromium family, namely molybdenum, tungsten, seaborgium, do not make. In chromium family, though it belongs to sixth group, only chromium makes hydrides. In seventh group, all elements not make hydrides. In eighth group, all elements don't make hydride. In ninth group, all elements don't make hydride. So it is a standard IIT mains model question. Are we very clear? Now, we have concluded about hydrides. We will go to textbook and look at the book now. Please look at the formula of hydrides made by lanthanides and D block elements. LaH 2.87. YbH 2.55. TiH 1.5 to 1.8. Meaning is, in YbH 2.55, meaning is, if I take 255 molecules, they have 255 hydrogens and only 100 tetrapyrenes. You understand? If I take 100 units, there are 100 YBs and 225 hydrogens, 255. They don't have a different formula. It changes. Compounds which don't have such different formula, which do not obey law of constant composition, are called as non-stoichiometric or interstitial hydrides. Always I have problem with the late joiners. Now I am locking the meeting. Sorry. I have no time to waste because I have to start a new idea and time is less. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I lock the meeting. Now I will not admit anybody. Abba. Sir, today there is a lot to discuss, sir. We need to discuss about water. Today I plan to talk to you a little bit about water, heavy water, hard water, and Arif sir has asked you to do problems on hardness of water. I will revise them because next week we have problems in the exam. Okay, now I am muting all and I am closing your locking meeting. Okay, first I start with an idea. ఇవాళ తీర్థం పెట్టలేదు, మర్చిపోయి దయచేవను. ఇవాళ కుదరలేదు. కొంచెం ఎన్ని నీళ్ళు వేసి ఎన్ని అమ్మో వద్దులే, మర్చిపోయా
చెప్పని చెప్పకూడదు. కొనుక్కోవాలి
వద్దు, ఆ నీళ్ళు వాడుకో, ఆ నీళ్ళు వాడుకు వద్దా. ఎప్పుడు అశ్రద్ధం వస్తుంది ఎందుకు? ఆ పటికి వెళ్ళాం కొంచెం ఆరోగ్యం పెంచాం. JL 41-34. I don't have time, man. JL 4134. I remove chesukuni ipoya. Okay, sir. Now we have no time to do anything. Now we have to go to the lesson. Okay. It is hanging. Okay. All of you, please look here. Now we are talking about water, sir. Hanging. Hello? Hello, Kajim sir. I am trying to search his name and time is getting wasted. So I have to complete the lesson. Now, JL 34. I am not able to see that fellow. JL 4134. Not able. I am not able to identify them. JL 41. I have tried actually. Time is getting wasted now. JL 4134. Why, what is the problem with that boy, sir? He is not in this section. Sir, he is not there, sir. Now I have no time, sir. I have to complete today's portion. Please allow me. I am searching. I am not able to see. I am not able to see here. You know, 80 names I have to search. Time is limited now. So it creates tension. Chota Bhim is there, yeah. Okay, I removed. Thank you. Okay. Hello? I have removed one fellow. Good. Hello? Now we are talking about water, sir. H2O. You know, the water available for agriculture purpose and for drinking is less than 1%. I have already removed, man. I have already removed thought of him. He is not there. Okay? Don't worry. I am not able to remove this boy. Okay. I have removed. Okay, I have removed. Sir, there is a water. 97% water is there in 97% water is there in oceans. And remaining water around 2% is there in ice caps and polar regions. The amount of water available for agriculture purpose, for drinking, all that is less than 1%. And the rivers contribute 0.0001% water. You say rivers are very mighty, very big, Ganges, Krishna, so many things you say. But the water present in rivers is very, very less really. So I wanted to maintain that the water is very essential for life, and for agriculture purpose and drinking purpose, less amount of water is available. It is to be conserved carefully. Water is having a form of H2O. Very interestingly, water is having a hydrogen locked to oxygen through covalent bond. In a covalent bond, there should be no charge separation. But unfortunately, oxygen being more electronegative takes the bonding electron pair close to itself, getting a minus delta charge, making hydrogen to get a little plus charge, plus delta. This partial charge separation, not full, partial charge. Or I can say polarity, positive pole and negative pole, observed in a water molecule brings a great changes to its properties. If you look at another water molecule, minus delta of oxygen of another water molecule attracts the H plus delta of next water molecule. This H plus delta is attracted by O minus delta of another water molecule. Like that, these attractions between different water molecules through the positive and negative charged ends called hydrogen bonding. Water has a special bonding called hydrogen bonding. Due to hydrogen bonding, millions of water molecules link together and water exists like H2O N types. Any such existence of water, millions of molecules together make water an associated liquid. There are only few associated liquids which have hydrogen bonding. This hydrogen bonding is a special type of bond that exists whenever hydrogen is locked to oxygen, or hydrogen is locked to fluorine, or hydrogen is locked to nitrogen. Only in these three cases you can have hydrogen bonding. Okay? So, hydrogen bonding is a very important concept which increases the boiling point and melting point of water abnormally. In 16th group, I have oxygen, sulfur, selenium, tellurium, polonium. In 14th group, I have carbon, silicon, germanium, tin, lead. If I look at the hydrates of 14th group, CH4, SiH4, GeH4, SnH4, PbH4. Down a group in hydrates, as always you go down, molecular weights increase. As molecular weight increases, the attraction between molecules increase. So the boiling points and melting points increase. In hydrates of any group, say 13th group, say 14th group, say 12th group, as you are going down, molecular weights increase and the boiling points, melting points increase. So in 14th group, CH4 has lowest boiling point, because it has lowest molecular weight. In 13th group, B2H6 has lowest boiling point, like AlH3, GaH3, InH3, TlH3. The lowest boiling point is there for the hydrate of first element. In 16th group, H2O, H2S, H2SE, H2TE, H2PO. The highest boiling point is there for water. Surprise, though water molecular weight is least in the hydrates of 16th group, its boiling point is highest. Why? Because of hydrogen bonding. This hydrogen bonding existing between different molecules is called intermolecular hydrogen bonding. Always intermolecular hydrogen bonding increases boiling point. Water is a universal solvent. Pure water has no color, no taste, no smell. Water is so important. In fact, the life originated in waters of oceans. I call it as saline water. One idea. If you ask a lady, or if you make a lady to deliver baby in ocean, waters of ocean. Normally, babies take birth in hospital beds in open air. But you make a baby, lady to deliver baby in seawater. Will the baby live or die? When the baby is delivered into ocean water, the baby will be very active, happy, and he will be or she will be alive. It will not die. And such children in Russia who have taken birth in seawater found to be having very good health than ordinary human beings. Nobody will die in ocean water because the water of oceans have same salinity as water in mother's womb called amniotic fluid. Actually, before delivery, the baby is in the water called amniotic fluid. When the baby is coming out, first it is exposed to air, so it gets irritated and cries. But if the delivery happens in oceanic waters, baby will be happy and comfortable. It will be swimming. No problem. That is the experiments conducted in Russia have shown. So I wanted to say from this that water is essential to support life, and the life originated in oceanic waters. Of course, I can't live in ocean, you can't live, because we don't know swimming. We lost that skill and we are scared of. Anyway, so sir, the water has unique properties. First unique property, you take any liquid or any solid, if you keep on heating, when it density decreases for any liquid or any solid, if you heat, density decreases. But for water, if you are heating from 0 degrees centigrade to 4 degrees, the density increases. This is a unique property. Notice, water has a unique property, like the density of water increases from 0 to 4 degrees on heating. In no other liquid, density increases on heating. Only for water it increases. No rejoin. Oxygen is there in oceanic waters in the dissolved form. Death will not happen. Oxygen is sufficient to support life in oceanic water if you know how to take it. Of course, our body cannot take the oxygen dissolved in water because our skin is so dry and it lost that ability. In mother's womb, the baby skin also takes oxygen. The configuration is different. And baby floats and it won't sink. It will keep the nose outside only by natural instinct. I'll talk and not talk on that subject. You can browse in YouTube. Check. Baby is delivered in oceanic waters. You'll be surprised. Anyway, now we have no time. So I want to say that no rejoining. I don't have time now. Sir, I conclude that water is the only liquid whose density increases from 0 to 4 degrees on heating. Water has maximum density at 4 degrees. The reason, at 4 degrees, hydrogen bonding is maximum. In solid ice, the hydrogen bonds give a case-like structure where molecules are away. When you are heating 0 to 4 degrees, some hydrogen bonds break, water molecules come close, density increases. So water has some unique properties. But mind you, pure water is colorless, odorless, tasteless. Tomorrow we are going to compare water with heavy water. Normal hydrogen makes ordinary water. Heavy hydrogen makes heavy water. You can make heavy water from water by electrolysis. Tomorrow we continue our talk on this. But today the time is up, so we are closing. Thank you very much.